campus, and welcome to our speakers. I want to tell you a little bit about Susannah Ural, and then I think she's going to tell you about the other people. I hope so, because I don't really think about them. Susannah is the co-director of the Dale Center for War, for the Study of War and Society in the History Department here at Southern Miss. A war and society scholar by training, she focuses on soldiers and families of the U.S. Civil War era. Her fourth book, Hood's Texas Brigade, The Soldiers and Families of the Confederacy's Most Celebrated Unit, will be released by LSU Press in November of 2017. She serves as vice president of the Mississippi Historical Society and will become that organization's president this March. In 2015, or 2 years ago, the College of Arts and Letters awarded Susannah the Moorman Distinguished Professorship in the Humanities, which offers significant funding for her, in her case, for her Beauvoir Veteran Project over the two-year period, 15 to 17 in her case. With a project team of Southern Miss undergraduate and graduate students, she is studying over 1,800 veterans, wives, and widows who lived at the Confederate Soldier Home at Beauvoir in Biloxi, Mississippi between 1903 and 1957 when it closed. The Beauvoir Veteran Project investigates impoverished Mississippi veterans and their families to see how the Civil War affected them and their communities, how representative they are of larger trends in the late 19th and early 20th century American South, and the evolution of American policies on veteran care. You can learn more about the project at beauvoirveteranproject.org. By my count, Susannah is the 11th Charles W. Moorman Distinguished Alumni Professor of the Humanities. That's impressive, right? I got to that count because I was the 6th Moorman professor and the first woman to have the honor. And I was delighted by being the first woman because Charlie Moorman would have hated it. So I want to tell you a little bit about Charles W. Moorman, who was quite a character. Any of you remember Charlie? He was quite a character, right? Charlie Moorman was a longtime professor of the English department. He was a medieval scholar of some national and international renown. He was a famously fabulous classroom teacher. He served as vice president for academic affairs here at Southern Miss. He was Paul Newman's college roommate, and he was an amateur potter in his later years after he retired. When I came in the early 80s, Charlie, who was pretty close to retirement at that point, had left administration and was back in the English department, teaching for his last couple of years before he retired. I was a new, very young faculty member. At that point, Charlie's role, self-appointed role, seemed to be amazingly cantankerous, to love to antagonize almost everyone in the department. He was smart and irreverent and fun and annoying to be around. If you know me at all, you will understand that I came to love and respect him a great deal. So thanks to Charlie for the Moorman Professorship, which many generations of us have used to produce interesting and, I hope, important scholarly work. And now let's hear from Susannah.
Thank you all so much for coming out tonight. I think it's one of the great traditions of the Moorman Professorship is at the end of your 2 years, you bring in some scholars and talk about not only what you've done over the last 2 years, but really kind of how it fits in with some of the leading historiography that's being produced in your field. And what I really wanted to do was highlight some of the great Civil War scholarship that's happening in the Gulf South right now. So I brought in three of my favorite historians, who I'm lucky are also three of my friends. And that's who you'll be hearing from tonight. Aaron Sheehan Dean is the Fred C. Frey Chair in Southern Studies at Louisiana State University. A graduate of the University of Virginia, he is the author, editor, or co-editor of 7 books, including Why Confederates Fought, Family and Nation in Civil War Virginia. His most recent. Hi.
I can't, you just get going.
His most recent work, contextualized analyzes and compares the practices of violence in the American Civil War with other civil and national conflicts in the mid-19th century. And his talk today is titled Duty to Run Mad, Veterans and Civil War Violence. He will be followed by Dr. Lesley Gordon, who is the Charles G. Summersell Chair of Southern History at the University of Alabama. A former editor of the academic journal Civil War History, she's the author of numerous books and articles, including General George E. Pickett in Life and Legend, and most recently, one of my favorites, a unit history titled A Broken Regiment, the 16th Connecticut's Civil War. A graduate of the University of Georgia, she's currently working on a book manuscript entitled Battlefield Cowardice, Violence and Memory in the American Civil War. Her paper today is titled A Higher Standard of Courage, Black Troops, Combat, and Memory of the War. Offering comments today is Ann Marshall, Associate Professor of History at Mississippi State University. She's also a graduate of the University of Georgia, with a number of publications that relate to her expertise in Civil War memory and 19th century women's history. She's best known for her book, Creating a Confederate Kentucky, The Lost Cause and Civil War Memory in a Border State. So starting us off, we'll be here.
Thank you all. Good evening. It's great to be here. Susannah, thank you. And Southern Miss, thanks for having me and my colleagues, all friends, which is one of the nice bonuses of being able to do these things here. And it's exciting to be old school and not have PowerPoint to distract. My PowerPoint was just a lot of old guys with beards. So there's one slide that was useful that had an actual image, and I will talk about that image, and you won't see it, but you can all Google it at the time when it comes, and otherwise, if you want to know it. Any Civil War generals look like, they're available on Wikipedia. One of the virtues of writing and teaching about the Civil War in the South is that we always have an audience, and this is proof of it, and usually a well-informed one. So I thought I would head off the entirely fair criticism that no doubt some astute audience member will file against me in the Q&A, which is that the quote that my paper takes its title from, The Duty to Run Mad, is actually from a World War I poem, Robert Graves, the English poet and soldier, who you may know from his memoir, but he wrote poetry as well, and he wrote a famous poem called Recalling War. And it seemed to me that Graves' poem captures the ambiguity in our eager embrace of war and the horror at its consequences. His characterization of World War I, he called it an infection of the common sky that sagged ominously upon the earth, satisfies for the Civil War as well. But it was his complex characterization of the job of a soldier, the duty to run mad, that intrigued me most. Civil War armies were filled almost entirely by volunteers. These were not men familiar with killing, but the war demanded they do that. We're often, as 19th century historians, we remind modern audiences that 19th century Americans were much more familiar with death than we are today, that infant and child mortality rates were much higher, that most people died at home. But saying that people in the 19th century were more familiar with death does not mean they were more familiar with killing. Once they volunteered, Civil War soldiers generally followed orders, even when those orders compelled them to do things like kill people that their lifelong moral codes prohibited. After the war, soldiers perhaps content themselves with the idea that they had a duty to kill, but how, I wonder, did they assimilate that part of themselves that ran mad once they returned to civilian life? Susannah alluded to my current project, which looks at the patterns and the nature of lethal violence in the Civil War. The one sentence summary of it is who could be killed and under what conditions in the Civil War. And so when Susannah asked me to participate in this event, I was intrigued to think about veterans who aren't proper sort of a subject of study in this, and to sort of consider how veterans wrote about the nature of the violence they participated in once the war was over. In this ongoing study, I'm particularly interested in violence outside the laws of war. And so I wondered, how did those people who participated in that kind of the Civil War's violence, how did they honestly confront the things that they participated in? What meaning did it have for them as people and as those who survived the war? It is hard to find a revealing or honest memoir that discusses the psychological burdens that killing imposed on soldiers. The medical records, asylum reports, and veteran home materials of the sort that turns up in the work Susannah's doing might speak to this response, and there are some other historians who are doing this work looking at medical records in particular to try to understand the kind of individual psychological experience. Most Civil War memoirists adopt a very detached, analytical perspective that sought to justify and explain rather than really probe in a psychological sense. But even the most self-serving recollections offer us clues as to how veterans sought to shape popular impressions of their wartime behavior. So a couple of caveats here to start before I launch into kind of the main event. The first is that I focus mostly on officers' memoirs. And so the honest answer is these are accessible, well-written, and skimmable. The intellectual defense of why I would use those is that these are the men who designed and implemented the practices that brought harm to so many people. Enlisted men have a ready excuse that they are accused of violating the laws of war. They are usually following orders. But the people who issued those orders can't fall back on that same excuse. And so it seems to me they merit attention in their own right here, and that's what I'm focusing on this evening. So first I want to highlight a few general characteristics that typify most officer memoirs, and then turn to two aspects of the war where soldiers most commonly operate outside the laws of war: guerrilla and counter-guerrilla operations, and then policies directed at non-combatants specifically. The one approach shared by almost every Civil War veteran writing an account of the war, and something that rarely appears in modern war memoirs, is the inclusion of transcripts of orders, of letters, and especially of exchanges with enemy officers. And some memoirs, I think, now having gone through many of them, might be more accurately characterized as document readers that happen to include a kind of autobiographical veneer. And what happens is that officers' writing in the post-war period include sort of official materials as opposed to pure recollection. And I think they do this partly as a way to buttress one's own claims against suspect actions. So in almost every case, letters or contemporary reports, almost always from superior officers or administrative officers, and best of all, presidents, appears in lieu of argument to kind of finesse the morality of the position that the officer assumed during the war. This is particularly pronounced when Union officers are writing and use Lincoln. Right, sort of having Abe on your side is a way to shield you from criticism. And it's as though authors want Lincoln's martyrdom to sort of cover and stretch to encompass them. The other commonplace technique is to adopt a tone of clinical detachment. And this is present in almost all Civil War memoirs. Sam Watkins' Company H, if you know it, is an exception in this sense. He anticipates the sort of fractured narratives and much more emotional style that typifies the most famous modern war memoirs by people like Michael Herr, Tim O'Brien, right, the things they carry, which we expect today, those memoirs, to give us that kind of psychological entry. Civil War veterans did not write that way. In this mode, the purpose of memoir became one man's view of the movement of the army over time. And it generates a detachment that can be seen most clearly when authors refer to what we would later call body counts without any self-consciousness about the lives at stake. John Mosby, in his memoir, for instance, uses the word kill to tally casualties in a given engagement. And he uses that word 94 times in his memoir, sort of kill, 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 only as this sort of signifier that's detached from any actual human meaning. Another strategy for avoiding a direct confrontation with violence, both just and unjust, is to ignore it, especially if the problem was culpability on your own side. Union General A.A. Humphrey, a corps commander and the chief of staff of the Army of the Potomac during the 1864 Overland Campaign, devoted a chapter of his recollections to the Battle of the Crater. This is a battle that happens outside Petersburg after a Union mine is detonated and then Union troops attack. If you know the battle, it's a disaster almost from the beginning for the Union. What Humphreys never mentions in a very detailed tactical description of the battle is that several regiments of black Union soldiers were inserted out of order into the attack at the last minute, and when the attack collapsed, these men were then shot down by Confederates after surrendering. The racial massacre at the Battle of the Crater is well documented by participants on both sides, which makes Humphrey's silence all the harder to fathom. Confederates rightly bear the responsibility for violating the laws of war in this instance by refusing to allow black men to surrender. But the Union's incompetence and cavalier mistreatment of its black soldiers helped create this deadly scenario. Humphreys, like many Civil War veterans, sidestepped the event rather than present an honest reckoning. As a subject for Civil War memory, guerrilla warfare was hard, although, as we will see, not impossible to ignore. Memoirs from both sides confronted the question of whether to directly address the role of operating as a guerrilla or operating in sort of counter-guerrilla operations. A charitable explanation for concealing either of these might be that authors were hoping to enable reconciliation. Ex-Confederates had an incentive to minimize the ways that they operated outside the laws of war in order to claim a seat at the table in post-war years. And ex-Union soldiers knew they would only re-alienate the White South by chronicling the often brutal methods that they used to suppress guerrillas. This is why guerrilla warfare is rarely, if ever, broached in the memoirs of leading figures in the war. But participants in that irregular war sometimes had trouble recusing themselves from these fights. So I want to start with Union General George Crook, who led one of the bloodiest campaigns against guerrillas in the Civil War. Crook had been an officer in the regular army in 1861. He had spent most of his time fighting Indians along the Pacific coast in California and Oregon. In his autobiography, Crook admitted to little difficulty in making the transition to Civil War when he was appointed to lead the 36th Ohio, which headed across the river into the contested mountains of western Virginia. Quote, being fresh from Indian country where I had more or less experience with that kind of warfare, Crook remembered, I set to work organizing for the task. The bushwhacking typified this region of the state, even in 1861, seemed to Crook a parallel to the Indian wars he had been fighting out west. Initially, they followed the procedures of regular war, arresting suspected guerrillas, many of them not regular soldiers, so technically civilians, and sending them to Camp Chase, a Union prison near Columbus, Ohio. When the same men were released a few months later and returned to bushwhacking, Crook adopted more brutal methods. Quote, when an officer returned from a scout, Crook reported, he would report that they had caught so-and-so, but in bringing him in, he slipped off a log while crossing a stream and broke his neck. Or that he was killed by an accidental discharge of one of the men's guns, and many like reports, but they never brought back any more prisoners. Crook's description here goes beyond just honest reporting. We can hear the wink in his narrative. In his flippant explanation for how suspected guerrillas were executed by his men stands as one of the most revealing admissions of this type. During the war, both sides executed prisoners unjustly in the manner that Crook intimates, quietly while marching prisoners to the rear, and then with a fig leaf of a story to cover the deed. But many of these were revealed during the war, and officers on both sides policed the treatment of their men when captured. If you read through the official records of the War of the Rebellion, they are filled with long correspondences between officers on both sides, debating exactly what happened to whom, at what point on the march, and who's responsible, and how they're going to be punished. Many of these missives reached the desks of Army commanders like Lee and Grant, who threatened each other with retaliation. Crook's willingness to brag about his methods in his memoir reveals a degree of continuity with Western Indian wars that few Americans then or now would like to consider. We prefer to regard the Civil War as a gentleman's affair of the 19th century or a brother's war conducted between rivals who treated each other civilly. Instead, Crook regarded Western Virginia Confederates, many of whom fought irregularly, as equivalent to the Indians he had fought in California and Oregon. He could have concealed the unlawful killings and still represented himself as tough on bushwhackers. His honesty speaks to his confidence in the justifications offered for suppressing Confederate irregulars. That confidence derived, I think, not just from Union victory, which many participants read backwards as basically sanctioning whatever they had done to attain it, but from the broad grant of military authority, from military necessity built into the North's code of conduct during the war. So I'm going to read a piece of Article 14. I did actually have two or three useful slides, one of which is this piece of what comes to be called the Lieber Code, General Orders Number 100. That's the rules governing the Union Army's behavior, issued in April of 1863. And Article 14 reads, military necessity, as understood by modern civilized nations, consists in the necessity of those measures which are indispensable for securing the ends of war and which are lawful according to the modern law and usages of war. Although historians disagree about whether the Lieber Code produced a more just conflict, several of its provisions provide the legal and philosophical cover for Northern officers to speak freely about wartime actions without fear of reprisal. This prominent jurist had already established the military necessity covered whatever needed to be done. Confederates faced more political obstacles in offering such a genuine appraisal of their actions in the war. One of Crook's adversaries in Virginia, John Singleton Mosby, established a singularly effective presence in the north central counties of Virginia's Piedmont by leading the 43rd Virginia Battalion, this is technically a partisan ranger unit, in raids against Union forces. Now, unlike most Western theater guerrillas in Missouri or Arkansas, Mosby never targeted non-combatants. His guerrilla force sought targeted Union soldiers, but his men frequently fought out of uniform and concealed their identities, blending into civilian life after their raids. And as a result, the Union categorized Mosby, despite having a commission, as a guerrilla. His response to the charge of being a guerrilla was that it, quote, simply means one engaged in the minor operations of war. Although I had never adopted it, I had never resented it as an insult. I had never resented as an insult the term guerrilla when applied to me. Mosby is clearly dissembling here. He knew that the Union's rules of conduct singled out men or squads of men, here again I'm quoting from the Labor Code, men or squads of men who commit hostilities without sharing continuously in the war, but who do so with intermitting returns to their homes and avocations, or with the occasional assumption of the semblance of peaceful pursuits, divesting themselves of the character or appearance of soldiers. Such men, the code declared, are not public enemies, and therefore, if captured, are not entitled to the privileges of prisoners of war, but shall be treated summarily as highway robbers or pirates, meaning they can be killed more or less on sight. By crafting a memoir that reads like all the other commanders' recollections, engagements, dramatic escapes, men captured, men killed, friends lost, perhaps Mosby hoped that he might overwhelm critics and the guerrilla argument would simply collapse on its own. On the other hand, at certain points in his text, Mosby offers a glimpse of his approach to warfare. Here he is describing an English officer serving with the North. He was familiar with the old rules of the schools, but he soon learned that they were out of date. If Mosby could not bring himself to confront the nature of his own command, he did offer an honest assessment of how he perceived the Union's campaign. Despite the vigor with which Mosby attacked Union troops in the Valley, he never critiqued Grant's orders for the Union's campaign in 1864. Although it was never implemented, at one point Grant threatened to arrest the families in Mosby's Confederacy, as this region was known, and have them sent to Union prison at Fort McHenry. In his memoir, Mosby rejected the argument that this was cruel or vindictive measure, instead writing, quote, it would have been a more humane way of getting rid of it than killing the men. More ominously, Mosby wrote that he expected if the Federals had pursued such a practice, rather than deterring his men, it would have spurred them to greater action. Northern soldiers, he wrote, would have felt all the wrath and imitated the example of the fierce Achilles, when he heard that Patroclus, his friend, had been killed and his armor captured. Now perish Troy, he said, and rushed to the fight. The Civil War in the Shenandoah Valley never attained the apocalyptic phase envisioned here by reference to the Iliad and the terrible close of the Trojan War. So I want to turn from guerrillas to violence directed at non-combatants. The widest reaching and most debilitating policy enacted against civilians by the Union Army was the banishment of 20,000 citizens from four western Missouri counties in 1863. This was implemented by General Thomas Ewing in response to the sack of Lawrence by Quantrill's raiders coming out of western Missouri and their massacre in that Kansas town of 150 civilians. By exiling guerrilla supporters, which is what this policy did, and cutting off their domestic supply line that sustained irregular warfare, Ewing believed guerrillas would have no choice but to give up their campaigns. He issued the order on August 25th of 1863, and by early September, families were on the march as Union soldiers burned thousands of homes. The human suffering in western Missouri was immense. Hundreds of people, mostly women and children, died as cold fall weather enveloped the exiles in their search for refuge. Ewing hoped that the General Order No. 11, which is the name given to this policy, would prove a permanent solution to the guerrilla warfare in the event it drove the guerrillas out for the year they returned again in 1864. Ewing operated in the District of the Border under the command of John Schofield, who was one in a sequence of Union generals operating in Missouri. And so I want to talk, Schofield writes a pretty lengthy memoir of how Schofield handled this issue. During the war, he stood fully behind the order. The measure which has been adopted seems a very harsh one, he wrote to Lincoln, but after the fullest examination and consideration of which I am capable, I am satisfied it is wise and humane. Rather than allow Southerners to claim that the order was simply knee-jerk vengeance, Schofield contextualized the order around the ongoing guerrilla problem. It was not adopted hastily as a consequence of the Lawrence Massacre. The subject had been long discussed between General Ewing and myself, and its necessity recognized as at least probable. After the war, Schofield claimed, quote, that the execution of this order was carried out without the loss of a single life or any great discomfort to the participants. This was patently false. Perhaps sensing the thin ice upon which he skated, Schofield avoided the topic almost entirely in his memoirs. The lone reference to it comes in a short section with the appallingly understated subheading of Trouble with the Lawrence Massacre. Here, Schofield quotes his own letter to Lincoln, which I had just quoted, in which he describes giving Ewing the authority to remove these families. The bulk of Schofield's narrative is devoted to reprinting letters or orders from Lincoln to Schofield or other Westerners. Again, this effort to kind of justify yourself with the words of other people more important than you were. Even a sympathetic reader can only interpret these pieces as a part of Schofield's effort to insulate himself from criticism, and that criticism came in many forms. Confederates had denounced the order as a savage assault on defenseless victims, and even many Unionists felt that it went too far and would only create more enemies. It was Schofield's misfortune to make an enemy of America's most prominent 19th century painter, George Caleb Bingham. Bingham is a Missourian who lives in the western part of the state. He's a Unionist, actually serves in a kind of Union unit in Missouri. But he opposed the order strongly and felt that it was egregious. After the war, he turned his brush to making Schofield infamous. Bingham's painting, Order Number 11, and that's the one useful slide that I would have shown you, which he completed in 1868, portrays Union soldiers murdering and desolating citizens of the region. It's a famous painting. As I say, Bingham is extremely well known at the time. He's done other historical paintings, and after the war, this one comes as a kind of personal passion for him. Schofield never mentions Bingham, though he certainly knew the painting, which had already immortalized the shame Bingham thought the army shared for its part in this episode. It may go too far to argue that when officers avoided speaking about episodes of unjust violence in their memoirs, that they implicitly revealed a guilty conscience. Schofield, in fact, demonstrates very little sympathy for the people of western Missouri, Confederate or Unionist, during the war, and I think he would have used Crook's military necessity defense if pressed. His editor did not press, so silence prevailed. Confederates did not enact any policy of equally broad impact, although their actions against the Unionists of East Tennessee grew harsh quite quickly. The closest they came in terms of the mistreatment of enemy civilians came during Jubal Early's retreat from his Maryland raid in 1864. After menacing Washington, this is when he goes up and sort of rides around Washington, Lincoln comes out and watches. His army moved back west, and then before passing into Virginia, he burned the town of Chambersburg, Pennsylvania. Early's army arrived at Chambersburg. It's an undefended and unfortified town, demanded $100,000 in gold, and failing to receive that, by the afternoon, they burned the town. No civilians were killed, though many suffered serious hardships as they lost homes and possessions. Early admitted the burning forthrightly in his memoir, maintaining that it was a fair retaliation against the burning of private homes in Virginia by David Hunter earlier that year, three homes in particular belonging to prominent Confederate politicians, and the more general destructive campaign waged by the Union Army. Quote, I came to the conclusion it was time to open the eyes of the people of the North to this enormity by an example in the way of retaliation. Early's lieutenant, McCausland, implemented it, but Early accepted full responsibility, noting in his memoir, notwithstanding the lapse of time which has occurred and the result of the war, I see no reason to regret my conduct on this occasion. A kind of crook-like honesty here. Beyond all other ex-Confederates, Early bore his military service with pride. He was a chief architect of the lost cause. So his defense of his conduct here is perhaps not surprising. He asserts an equivalence between his burning and that done by the Yankees. And this is one of the prerequisites of lawful retaliation. They have to be proportional. Though, as Early knew at the time, the Union Army destroyed mostly public resources, particularly in the Valley, and burned private homes only if they were implicated in guerrilla actions. The private homes burned by Hunter in his 1864 Valley campaign were indeed unjustly destroyed, but a genuine retaliatory order would have singled out the same number, less than five, and explained the action in those terms. Early's order stemmed from a desire for vengeance at the war's unbalanced toll on Southern versus Northern civilians. One might sympathize with this imbalance, but revenge is not retaliation. Early spent his post-war years lionizing Robert E. Lee. For him, the Confederate cause could be protected best by maintaining the fiction that the war was fought to defend state rights and only an honorable man like Lee. Any honest reckoning with the true nature of the Civil War risked the political goals of that edifice. Unlike Mosby, who confronted the brutality of the war, even if he rejected the label of guerrilla, quite honestly, Early chose not to address it, confining his post-war narrative to a chronological narrative of his army's exploits and a hagiography of Lee. I'm going to, well, let me give you one paragraph. And do I have like 2 minutes? Sherman, in one paragraph, and then I'll wrap up here. The greatest burner of the Civil War, of course, was William T. Sherman. Sherman's memoirs are among the classics of American literature. They're written by the 19th century's greatest raconteur, and they still make for good reading. They honestly portray the hard war that Sherman brought to the South, particularly in 1864. In the chapter chronicling the March to the Sea, Sherman opens by reprinting his first field order setting out the rules for the march. Sherman authorized his men to, quote, forage liberally on the country during the march, but prohibited soldiers from entering private dwellings. If the soldiers encountered no resistance, they could not destroy any property. But if guerrillas attacked them or citizens burned bridges, then, quote, wrote Sherman, army commanders should order and enforce a devastation more or less relentless, according to the measure of such hostility. By republishing this phrase, devastation more or less relentless, I'm not sure that there's only a more relentless, less relentless devastation. Sherman frankly publicized his designs rather than conceal those he had for the state. Later in the same memoir, of course, he describes the Northern Army as desolating Georgia. Like Union officers, Sherman drew strength from the Union's defense of military necessity, and that gives him, I think it emboldens him to address these claims. Perhaps it was unrealistic to expect that former officers would honestly confront the worst aspects of the Civil War. Initially, some worried about staying out of prison or the gallows, and then they had political and business careers to consider. To be honest, though, I expected more from John Mosby, who sets the gold standard for honest reckoning with the causes of the war. Mosby was incensed by the whitewashed brand of state rights nostalgia being peddled by people like Jubal Early. In the Standard Lost Cause account, slavery was incidental to the war. Mosby disagreed. Quote, if it was right to own slaves as property, it was right to fight for it, he said. The South went to war on account of slavery. South Carolina went to war, as she said in her secession proclamation, because slavery would not be secure under Lincoln. South Carolina ought to know what was the cause for her seceding. But when it came to reckoning with the decision for his men to conceal their identity as regular soldiers and slip back among the civilian population, a hallmark of guerrilla fighters, Mosby dodged. Others on both sides dodged worse. But their collective silence, obfuscation, and dishonesty had real consequences. Americans of the late 19th and 20th century viewed the Civil War as a sequence of honorable and fairly conducted battles. It was that, but it was also irregular guerrilla warfare, the punishment and occasional killing of civilians, the persistent, unjust execution of black soldiers by Confederates, gross deprivation and mistreatment of prisoners on both sides. The list goes on. In the past decade, historians have worked to restore a more realistic view of the war, incorporating both the restraint that each side exercised and the moments when they abandoned that restraint. This historical detective work has been difficult, partly because the men who designed and directed unjust actions during the war refused to confront them in the years after it. It is high time that we did. Thank you.
Points out
that during the 19th century, in the time of the Civil War, the belief was a man who was a coward in war would be a coward everywhere else. So it was a question of character. Although much of the work that has been done on it, including Gerald Linderman, who writes about it in his important book about battle courage, is clear that the term, notions of cowardice, all this was in flux. There was so much changing, and soldiers were adapting to this terrible war. But central to ideals and expectations and assumptions about cowardice, especially when the war began, was that violence was important in shedding the label, the shameful label of being a coward, that you had to prove yourself in battle. And dying, right, proved that you weren't a coward. Battle scars, obviously, we know the famous Red Badge of Courage, Stephen Crane's book that came out after the war. Set that in print, some of these questions. But regiments with higher casualty numbers proudly proclaim themselves heroes just because of that, right? That they had lost more men. And this somehow was a pushback on any suspicion that perhaps they hadn't performed well. William Fox, in his book, Regimental Losses in the American Civil War, wrote, the wars and battles are considered greater in proportion to the loss of life resulting from them. And he said, I think very insightfully, bloodless battles excite no interest. And the same I would say about regiments or soldier stories. If it's not the gory stuff, then who really cares? And if it's not the gory stuff, then perhaps maybe you weren't a good soldier, maybe you weren't very honorable. So it just hasn't, for a number of reasons, I think just studying cowardice hasn't proved very interesting, very satisfying. And recently, there's been some pushback that we shouldn't talk about it at all. Gary Gallagher and Katie Meyer, in an article a few years ago in a journal of Civil War History, said that talking about something like cowardice implies, and they say it's very hard to find any examples of it, it implies that soldiers were somehow victims. And they're talking about other things, not just cowardice, desertion, atrocity, war atrocities, that it portrays the war in too much of a negative way somehow. Soldiers, we need to look at the positives. Well, I'm not trying in any way to judge morally what these men did or didn't do, but I'm really interested in what happened and how they try to make sense of it. And so that's what drives this project. And I'm looking at a variety of regiments. I'm trying to get a good sample, north and south. But tonight I want to talk about black troops. Because they, the questions of cowardice and heroism was just, they were just important, as important to them as they were to white soldiers. And I'm trying to get at what it was like for them, right, in these situations in combat and how they dealt when they had expectations put upon them that in many ways were different, of course, than white soldiers. Now, other scholars have already written quite a bit about African-American manhood, combat, quality, and tied it directly to expectations of heroism. I think it's pretty fair to say that many of us as scholars take it for granted that African-American troops saw military service as a way to challenge pernicious racist stereotypes, that they were incapable of behaving bravely in combat. In April 1863, Frederick Douglass, who was trying very passionately to raise troops for the Union, he talked about this specifically. He said, quote, to fellow African-American men, you are a member of a long enslaved and despised race. Men have set down your submission to slavery an insult to a lack of manly courage. They point to this fact as demonstrating your fitness only to be a servile class. You should enlist and disprove this slander and wipe out the reproach. When you shall be seen nobly defending the liberties of your own country against rebels and traitors, brass itself will blush to use such arguments, imputing cowardice against you. So Douglass assumed, as again I think a lot of historians have as well, that once African Americans proved themselves in battle, those questions would start to disappear. But if we dig deeper, we find it a lot more complicated. I came across this discussion about cowardice, black and white, in the official records. It's September 1863, and Major Thomas Brooks, who was an engineer in South Carolina, he wrote his fellow officers raising this very question about the fitness of black troops. And he said in this circular, which is published in the official records, that the important experiment which will test the fitness of the American Negro for the duties of the soldiers now being tried, it is desirable that facts bearing on the question be carefully observed and recorded. Crooks sought an impartial and carefully prepared answer to a series of questions. And central to this, again, was would black troops withstand enemy fire? Would they turn and run? And he got six responses. And he summarized them as all agreeing that the black is more timorous than the white, but is in corresponding degree more docile and obedient, hence more completely under control of his commander and much more influenced by example. One of the respondents, Captain Joseph Wheeler from, he was a New York volunteer engineer, he said, quote, I will say in my opinion, African-Americans' courage is, and he said there, I'm saying African-Americans, courage is rather of the passive than the active kind. They will stay, endure, resist, and follow, but they have not the restless, aggressive spirit. And he went on to say, I do not believe they will desert their officers in trying moments in so great numbers as the whites. They have not the will, audacity, or fertility of excuse of the straggling white, and at the same time, they have not the heroic, nervous energy or vivid perception of the white who stands firm or presses forward. Walker could not remember any instances of black men running away, but he remembered many instances of white men running away. He concluded, as far as African-American soldiers went, that they were mediocre. They were mediocre. You could not have high expectations of them in battle. But he talked about passive courage, which I found really fascinating, this whole notion of passive courage. A year later, January 1864, when increasing numbers of black men were coming into the ranks of the Union Army, a member of the 55th United States Colored Troops wrote a response, in many ways, I think, to this discussion, this very public question about whether black men could fight and were dependable in battle. And this was published in a weekly Anglo-African. And he talked about the fact, and remember that most black troops, right, there's about 180,000 men that serve the Union Army, and most of those men never saw battle. Most of them were used for fatigue duty, for digging ditches, for manning garrisons. They were not called into battle. And he talks about that very fact. He says that kind of duty requires what he called a higher standard of courage. Because when they're vulnerable, and as he says, they can't fight back with no means of returning fire. He said, they bear themselves in a cool and soldierly manner, doing their duty without complaint, and that duty is forced upon them. And he argued, this deserves credit. So he's trying to redefine, again, courage for these African-American men who don't have that opportunity to fight in the front lines, but nonetheless should be given credit. Well, I've been looking closely at the 8th United States Colored Troops. They're from Philadelphia. In fact, there were several units raised in Philadelphia of black troops, but this one in particular drew my attention because they are accused of cowardice at the Battle of Biloxi. If you know very much about Biloxi, it's kind of a obscure battle. It happened on February 20, 1864 in Florida. And, look, it does not compare to a Gettysburg or a Vicksburg in any way. It's certainly not as significant, certainly not as heavily numbers. Again, comparatively so. But it was very important for black troops because there were three different units that fought there. The Union, the famed 54th Massachusetts, which if you've seen the movie Glory, you know about them, with Bill Wagner. The 35th USCT, a relatively green unit. They had been the first North Carolina. And then the 8th USCT. This battle originated with the Union trying to get a kind of footprint into Florida with the belief that there were actually loyal Unionists there, and it really didn't amount to much after this fiasco for the Union. But the federal troops come in there and quickly, like what happens with many Civil War battles, basically a cavalry skirmish turns into a large-scale engagement with both infantry, artillery, and cavalry involved. In every account, if you start to dig deep, you will find that the 7th New Hampshire were some of the first troops engaged. And the 7th New Hampshire, a white unit, panicked and ran away. And when they ran away, the 8th USCT, which was also in line close by on the left flank, they break and run away. Eventually, by the end of the day, the Union commander realizes this is a defeat, and he calls for a retreat. Some of the troops covering, or two of the units covering the retreat, were the 54th Massachusetts and the 35th USCT. What happened? Well, the colonel of the 7th New Hampshire, in his official report, talks about receiving conflicting orders, that his men began to move forward and they're ordered to essentially move in a completely different direction. He also complains that they had guns they didn't essentially know how to fight, or they were poor quality. Now, the 7th New Hampshire had a very interesting situation. They, like the 7th Connecticut, also engaged, had been outfitted with Spencer repeating rifles. If you know anything about those guns, that was getting to be really high tech, right, for Civil War armies. Well, they had been carefully trained in these guns. But 1 week before the Battle of Lesley, those guns were taken away from them. And they were given what many of them complained to be completely useless Springfield rifles. And that's a whole story in itself, and I can get into that if you like. But the heart of the matter is the 7th New Hampshire went into battle confused with guns that they were angry about having to have, and some of them apparently did not know how to use. But none of that really becomes public. What becomes public is the account of the 8th USCT. There was a letter written by Lieutenant Eddy of the 3rd Rhode Island Battery, and he singled out the 8th USCT for special censor. In a letter that made its way, I found it in nearly every major northern newspaper, including the New York Times. It first appeared in a Providence newspaper in the hometown, essentially the hometown for this Rhode Island unit. And he talks about his unit being completely devastated in the battle. He said they suffered 50% casualties, all their gun, 50 horses gone, as well as two of their four pieces of artillery. Quote, this is Eddie, "It was our misfortune to have for support a Negro regiment, who by running caused us to lose our pieces." Now, when this letter appeared in the Philadelphia Public Ledger, which is the hometown of the 8th USCT, the editors included the caption, "Bad conduct of a Negro regiment." This charge was so serious that years later, historian Frederick Binder claims that it set back any kind of perceived progress for black troops, period. Didn't matter that the 54th did fine, that the 35th USCT did fine. It was the 8th USCT that's going to get all this bad press. A correspondent in the New York Herald, who apparently was there on the field, described how once the 8th USCT lost their colonel, which happened pretty soon after they became engaged, that they completely broke in what he called, quote, disorder. And that was the end of the battle, essentially. That was like a domino effect. Well, there were defenders. Their regimental surgeon, A.P. Heichold, very much wanted to counter this image of the 8th USCT panicking and fleeing in battle. A letter that was published in the Christian Recorder on March 12th was directed toward Philadelphia supporters of black troops. And he blamed poor preparation in advance of the fight. I have to understand, too, that this unit had only recently left Pennsylvania. It left Pennsylvania in January of 1864, and they were green as green could be. They had never been in battle before. And many officers complained that they just didn't, like the 7th, they, for different reasons, didn't know how to use the 7th New Hampshire, didn't know how to use their rifles. He described men, quote, "dropping like leaves in autumn. Still they went, without faltering or murmuring, until they came within 200 yards of the enemy, when struggles for life and death commenced. They withstood this withering enemy fire for more than 2 hours." And here the doctor wrote, "On the field of Lesley was decided whether the colored man had the courage to stand without shelter, risk the dangers of the battle, risk the dangers of the battlefield. And when I tell you that they stood with fire in front, on their flank, and in their rear for 2.5 hours without flinching, and when I tell you the number of dead and wounded," right, this is the sign of being a hero, "I have no doubt as to the verdict of every man who has gratitude for the defenders of his country, white or black." Now, questions were swirling about the 8th, and also amongst officers in the 7th. None of this I have yet to find out coming out in public, at least initially, about 7th New Hampshire. But General Thomas Seymour, and he's the one who's overseeing this attack, he writes in the official records in late March to defend essentially what happened to his men. He mentions the, what he calls the colored troops, and he says they behaved credibly. He talks about the 54th, he talks about the 35th. But he says this, which I found fascinating. Quote, it was not in their conduct, meaning the black troops, that can be found the chief cause of failure, but in the unanticipated yielding of a white regiment, from which there was every reason to expect noble service, and at a moment when everything depended upon its firmness. So Seymour had high expectations of his white soldiers, and they failed him. Did not have such expectations, at least the way he's expressing himself in this official report for the 8th USCT or the black troops. Lieutenant Oliver Norton, a white officer whose previous service record included Boron, Antietam, Gettysburg, this is a veteran, and he wrote private letters to his sister and his father about a lustee. So he's a white officer in the 8th USCT. And his letters are quite remarkable in how descriptive they are. He talks about coming into battle, and a few other quick details about this unit. Not only had they never fought before, but apparently they were called into battle, and they had all their accoutrements. They had their knapsacks, they had their canteens, they had everything. Often men shed whatever they didn't need when they went into battle, and they ran a half a mile with all this heavy equipment. And their guns were unloaded. So then they get toward the front lines, and remember, the 7th New Hampshire is already starting to break, and they're called to stop and begin to fire. And it's a fiasco. But Norton, who really struggled with trying to admit, he talks about their paralyzing fear. He refused to see his men as anything but heroic, despite their apparent collapse. He said, quote, I want justice done to the regiment. I don't claim that they fought well, only as well as they could, and that the officers had all they could to get them to fall back at the first halt. By the summer of 1864, he had come to the point where he told his sister that he actually preferred black troops over white troops, that they were better fighters. So this kind of interesting public and private question about, can black men fight, and are they dependable? As I said, it just hasn't made its way into the historiography. One quick quote from Joseph Blattar, who wrote probably the best book about the relationship between black troops and white officers, said that black troops just weren't as scared of battle. He said they weren't as anxious as white soldiers. He writes, quote, with black troops, especially freedmen, their sense of anxiety was not so powerful. Many of them had already demonstrated unusual fortitude in their escape from slavery. More importantly, they had motivations that enabled them to overcome these doubts better than did white soldiers. Now, of course, yes, many of these men, now the USCT men were, many of them were actually freemen, but they had not been enslaved. But does that mean that they weren't scared? They're human beings, right? And combat was absolutely terrifying. So today, my research on this topic has shown that being called a coward was devastating to units, white or black. In the case here, we see both black troops and white troops panicking and behaving poorly, not entirely due to their own fault, of course, but the charge of cowardice rested heavily on the 8th USCT. For the 7th New Hampshire, it didn't come out initially publicly. Later in their regimental history, the author will really fight hard in proving that they were brave and that any poor performance on that day was due to their officers and due to this question of guns. Now, just quickly jumping ahead to present-day Lustie. Today, do people remember this? Do they think about it? There's not much mention of black troops in Lustie. It's got more attention, certainly, from historians and increasing concern with remembering what black troops did. But if you go to Lustie today, you will find three monuments, and they're all from the Confederacy. There's not one to the Union at all. So I think we'll have to wait quite a while to even get any recognition of what happened there and the complexities to it. Thank you.
Thank you all. I've been sitting here in terror. I forgot to silence my phone, and it's been sitting there the whole time. And thank you for your patience. patience with our technology. If y'all remember the movie, The Outlaw Josie Wales, some days the magic works, some days it doesn't. When I started the Beauvoir Veteran Project, I had just moved to Mississippi, and I heard that there was a Confederate home on the Gulf Coast, at what most of you know is Beauvoir. And I called down, forgetting that if you really want to get anywhere, you really should go in person. And they said, yeah, no, we don't have anything. And I went over to McCain Archives here on campus and met with Jennifer Brannan, and she said, no, we have some things. And I started digging, and I found some things down at Beauvoir eventually, the Jefferson Davis Presidential Library, and that they had some records. But what I never found in about the first year and a half of just dabbling with this project was what I really wanted, what we think about as traditional sources, letters, diaries, a home newspaper. Some of these homes had their own newspaper. Something that would help me get at what I wanted to know, which was, for the residents of the Mississippi Confederate home, how did they remember the Civil War? What did they think about how others were remembering the war? And I wanted to know, I mean, well into the 20th century, as, you know, there's some widows at the home who were born after the war. Okay, they really don't have any memory. What did it mean to them? And I also just wanted to, I was curious to know what we know about Confederate homes. Are we right? There's an image, there's one main book on Confederate homes, and then there's a couple of books about Civil War veterans' experiences overall. And there's an image of these homes as being horribly depressing. These men are basically just kind of shuttered off from society. That you have to be impoverished to be allowed access to these homes. You're basically a ward of the state, and you are treated like one. You are known as inmates. That is how they all still appear. When you find them in the census records, you are inmates. And it's a very unhappy image that we have. But the problem was, I couldn't get letters, and there weren't any diaries. The source base was incredibly limited. I happened to run into Charles and Jane Sullivan. Some of you know Charles Sullivan. He's a Mississippi historian who teaches down at the Perkins Mississippi Gulf Coast Community College. And he told me, no, there's records. His wife Jane had been collecting them for about 10 years. And I was like, what are you talking about, there's records? Where? Well, what she had decided to do was get into newspapers. And for those of you who get excited about this kind of stuff like I do, there are thousands, hundreds of thousands of pages of newspapers dating from the 18th century up until 1924, when copyright laws interfered, that are being digitized from all across the country. And so what's been happening is Jane and Sullivan has been going in, anywhere she can find an account of a Beauvoir resident, she's been collecting these. Before Jane started doing this, did you start before Jane or after Jane? Before Jane started doing this, Lisa Foster back there she just wanted to know more about the home, and then she started working there, and then you started helping it recover after Katrina. This was the subject of Lisa's undergraduate honors thesis, and sure enough, Lisa's like, oh yeah, that's where you're going to find a lot of them. Of course, Lisa was also doing this with records that had only been microfilmed. So I suddenly realized, what if, rather than looking at what the residents of the home thought about the war, what if we looked at the home and thought about and asked questions about what we actually understand about the home? And in particular, I wondered if this could offer any insights into just the history of veteran care overall. If you know anything about this subject matter, the United States has a fairly mixed record when it comes to fulfilling its promises to the men and women it sends to war. You can date this back to colonial days. My favorite example comes from my colleague Kyle Zellner's book about King Philip's War, where Massachusetts militiamen had to wait for 55 years before the leaders of Essex County decided to award them the land grants the men had been promised to go fight. So I was like, so how did Mississippi do? Maybe we could use this as a case study of veteran care. And so I started digging into everything I could, and it was getting easier and easier by the year because everything's being digitized and it's keyword searchable. So you have records from newspapers, you have military service records if you've ever used the database Fold 3, you have census records available through Ancestry and free on FamilySearch.org, and you also have, pension records as well. So we can really get get a sense of who these individuals are. There's also a register of the home of the over 1,800 residents, so we know who was there. And I started digging, and I started digging, and I started digging, and I realized I was never going to go through this. So I was like, all right, we're taking a 10% sample, we're going to make it nice and random, and I'm going to get my students involved. Because this is, these are skills they should know. And plus it helps, right? I mean, if you don't know me yet, I'm from the north, I'm not from here. So they're talking about these counties, and I'm always asking my staff, I'm saying it wrong, aren't I? And they're like, yeah, you are. these would be great skills for the students to learn, and plus it would also get the community involved. And so the Gunnifsons are here tonight, and their daughter Joanna was one of my first guinea pigs. And if you know anything about Joanna Gunnifson, she's one of our great history majors. She doesn't quit. And even Joanna, by about October, was like, wow, this is a lot of work. Because if you've done this research, they, you know, they'll show up in the 1850 census, but then they don't reappear until the 1910 census, right? And how many of you in this room have actually helped with the Beauvoir Veteran Project? There we go. And we have two more who are fixing to this semester. So I realized I had gone from a situation where I didn't have enough sources to a situation where we were drowning in sources. And this is where I thought about the Moorman Professorship. The Moorman Professorship would allow me to hire researchers in the summer, massively speeding up the process of getting through this data, so that we could actually make a meaningful contribution to the scholarship in a timely manner, and at the same time, students will be getting outstanding research skills, they'd be learning these skills, we had the community involved in the process, and the students got summer money, which, let's be honest, is very important. And I want to pause here and just make sure everybody understands what endowments like the Moorman Professorship provide. Humanities, we don't tend to get the kind of funding that STEM gets. We will never cure cancer. We can't make the roads safer or buildings safer. But we can tell you about who we are and who we've been and maybe where we should be going as a society. And the Moorman Professorship let me look at Beauvoir as this case study to understand, yes, Mississippi in the Civil War era, and yes, the people who came out of that world, but also, as a nation, how we care for veterans in this case study. So, what have we found? A couple interesting findings are coming out. We're wrapping up the project at the end of this summer of 2017. And the first major surprise we uncovered with Beauvoir Veteran Project is that while most Confederate homes were all male, Beauvoir was just the opposite. Veterans and their wives or widows all lived at the home. From 1916 through the early 1940s, with only a brief four-year absence, the superintendent of Beauvoir was either L. Nathan Tart or his wife, Helen. Women started serving on the board of the Beauvoir home in the 1920s, another rarity of Confederate homes. Second, historians have argued that veterans who lived and died at Confederate homes were, quote, the poorest of the poor. And the vast majority of these were lifelong bachelors or recently widowed men. Beauvoir challenges this as well. The men and women who lived there were poor when they arrived. But the average resident's income, well, wealth in 1860, or that of their parents, was about $8,500, making them very financially comfortable for the mid-19th century. While there, their family suffered on average an 84% loss. These numbers, again, are coming from our sample. They suffered an 84% loss of their wealth after the Civil War. The average personal and real estate value of Beauvoir veterans in 1870 was still a comfortable $1,300. So while, you know, they may technically be the poorest of the poor, when they arrived at Beauvoir, they did not grow up that way, which then led us to realize, well, that means they've been enjoying certain levels of education, certain levels of health care, certain levels of nutrition, that we don't traditionally associate with these homes. There's the assumption that most of the residents are semi-literate, illiterate, and have been suffering from challenges of poverty for much of their lives. Third, we also were surprised to find out that while most of the homes are portrayed as kind of an end point for these veterans and their wives and widows, in Beauvoir, what we found out is a lot of them kind of come and go. They'll come and stay for a while, and then they'll go home. That it's referred to as an honorable discharge in the register. A couple of them get a dishonorable discharge. My favorite is a woman. I think she was involved in some drunken situations. But they'll come for a while, and then and they'll go home, so certain family members will be able to take care of them. We've even uncovered one recently where it looks like, I mean, her daughter was a teacher in Gulfport, and she was living with her daughter and then would briefly go to Beauvoir and then would leave again. And she did this like three separate times. And one of the things we're wondering about is if the possibility is she was accessing the hospital at Beauvoir that was for the residents of the home, and that this was a way to get medical care that she very much needed. In terms of occupations of the residents, you're probably not surprised to learn that most of them were farmers. But there were a lot of labor skills showing up in the records. In terms, we have blacksmiths, we have salesmen, we have all of just lawyers, we have all sorts of people, and I think Lindsay is our favorite is the farmstress, an independent woman farmer. In terms of geography, it's not surprising. This part wasn't surprising at all. Most of the residents come from modern day I-20 or below. Which makes sense in terms of, if you're we have some coming from as far north as Corinth, for example, but if you're coming from that far, you're probably not going to be able to go back and visit with family or anything like that. So most of the people are coming from south of I-20. So our findings to date are not what I expected, which is a very good thing. We like to be surprised in this field. In the end, I think what we can take from Beauvoir at this point and from the Veteran Project is it's revealed that a lot of what we thought we knew about Mississippi's Confederate home was wrong. The project is revealing something quite troubling as well, and we're still investigating this. Mississippi counties began providing for impoverished Confederate veterans and their families as early as the fall of 1861, as Lisa discovered in her research. But our data shows that it is overwhelmingly Mississippians who came from the middle class in the 1860s and 1870s who enter Beauvoir when it opened in 1903. That leads us to ask what happened to the veterans and families who ranked among the state's poorest members during and immediately after the war. And what we suspect is those, for the most part, those individuals had died by the time Mississippi was providing a home for its veterans and families. On the other hand, for those who needed refuge by the early 20th century, the Jefferson Davis Soldier Home served its purpose. Our study has revealed that the residents overall did not see themselves as trapped in stately mansions, stately prisons of gratitude, excuse me, as one historian has described the homes. The home provided exactly what Mississippians hoped it would for the men they had called and required to serve and the families from which much sacrifice was demanded. With its hospital, library, chapel, dormitories, gardens, and outbuildings that looked out on the Gulf Coast, Beauvoir, in many ways, is a rare success story. So the project that had almost collapsed at the starting gate is challenging accepted historical notions about Civil War veterans while reminding us of the value of local studies that capture the complex nature of the post-Civil War South. It is also addressing broader questions of America's evolving policies on caring for veterans and their families, revealing where we have failed, but also where we have succeeded. And in that case, the Beauvoir Veteran Project and the Moorman Professorship is serving its purpose. Thank you all very much. Dr. Marshall is going to offer some comments on the papers, and then we will be available for some questions from the audience.
Overstate how great that is because it's sort of one of those those things that's fallen out of favor in the academy, but the research skills that you get by doing that kind of history are just so great. So it's really nice to see that you all are doing that here and that it's yielding such great results. What it's revealed is that the status of veteranhood could present men, and in this case some women, with opportunities for support and care and assistance, not just for long term, but for the short term. And also for conditions, they're being given assistance for conditions, it seems, not directly connected to their service, because it's coming so far after the war. And it's telling, and interesting that Susannah started the project intent on interrogating the veterans' own memories of the war, but as she explained, had to change courses when the sources, therefore the veterans' voices, weren't there. Her decision to flip the question to see what the evidence tells us about them has yielded some really fascinating results that challenge our traditional understandings of veterans' homes as these male-dominated places filled with old, grizzled, destitute veterans whose next destination is the pearly gates of heaven. Instead, what Susanna and you all have discovered is that the veterans didn't consider themselves pitiable, and nor did it seem did the outside world. And their dependence on the state of Mississippi did not seem to present a social stigma that dependency sometimes produces. It was seen rather as a reward for service well rendered decades earlier. So I'm curious to see where this project's going to go after this. I can see some really interesting work coming out of something that Susannah didn't mention. There's a dining hall log, apparently, that you all found. I think if you study that, you could come up with some really interesting findings about what World War, early 20th century, World War I era, 7-8, that would be a really great contribution to the burgeoning field of food history, which is very hip right now. And of course, I think that we'd all love to know more about that criteria that made for either an honorable or a dishonorable discharge from the home. And it's really interesting that a half century or more after serving in the military, these veterans and their conduct were still being judged by military standards and assessed in military parlance. When her presentation, Lesley Gordon, turned our attention to the understudied topic of cowardice in war. In particular, the story of the 8th USCT at the Battle of Alesti is as fascinating as it is frustrating. Here we see how military actions on the ground, so often unclear in any battle, were deliberately misreported, casting African-American troops as cowards, thus sparing white units involved in that battle of that indignity, and of course, in the process, turning the 8th USCT into scapegoats for Union defeat. Gordon shows us that this obfuscation was all too easily successful when subsequent accounts of USCT cowardice were fed through white Northerners' preconceived notions of black martial inferiority. And she left one fascinating morsel out of this talk, probably in the interest of time, but it was in the paper she gave me, that in one of the monuments at the Battle of Alesti, put up by the United Daughters of the Confederacy, and in their narrative, their commemorative narrative of this battle, they basically acquit the 8th USCT of cowardice by accusing the white Yankees of throwing these black troops under the bus. And so I think it's fascinating. Shows the multiple axes on which these interpretations of soldier conduct turn. So I think this is a captivating and interesting topic. It really highlights the high price that individuals and units faced when they were judged to be less than valorous. Aaron Sheehan Dean, with his focus on the deeper nature of killing during the Civil War, asks under what conditions soldiers did the killing that we take for granted as a natural part of war. And in the case of the work he presented tonight, what did they think about it? How did they make sense of it, not just for themselves, but for other people years after it happened? His findings based on a number of personal memoirs of officers are really interesting. They illustrate that the shapers of these narratives were simultaneously playing offense and defense as they sought to explain death and killing. And importantly, his work points to a larger question which asks just how circumscribed the realm of possible public discourse surrounding memories of the war might have been. But I'd like to push Aaron a little bit as he continues to work on this project to complicate and interrogate the assumption that Civil War soldiers were not familiar with killing, or at least were unprepared for killing. And assumption, you know, full disclosure, in part because I spend my day studying 19th century Kentucky, where white men of all economic classes customarily strapped pistols and bowie knives to themselves, armed to the teeth, as they walked through their daily lives, ready to, you know, defend their bodies and their personal honor from attack at any turn. So this is always on my mind. But so it's not to undercut the Aaron's point that killing was unfamiliar. It's only to say that the combatants' personal backgrounds and experience, geographic origin, and class status would have all played into the way that they would experience killing in the war. One could see, for instance, how a private from backcountry Missouri might have experienced more deathly violence before coming to war than one from the urban Northeast. Alternately, many African-American troops entered the Union Army having previously lived as slaves their entire life. They would come at the possibility of taking white lives with an entirely different mindset, right, than white troops. So I think these a priori experiences make a difference, and that this could turn out to be a really fascinating line of inquiry. But to circle back to my earlier point, these scholars here tonight have all in various ways underscored how important it was who told the stories of the Civil War, which stories they told, and how they told them. And specifically, they have focused on issues of soldier conduct and whether it was proper or in accordance with accepted rules of war. And most importantly, whether it bore up to the American public's expectations of a good fight. And they all touch on just how much is at stake when it comes to portraying war. Unless you are a history professor just trying to get tenure, you don't write a book thinking that no one is going to read it. This is true of Aaron's soldier and memoirist, right? They were writing for an audience, that is the American reading public, who was voraciously consuming accounts of battle in the books that they were writing and in monthly magazines like Century Magazine in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. These consumers expected not just to read about the past, but to be reminded of the experiences of people who lived through it and to learn about what kind of people that the war had made them into. Writers understood that there was a need to shape the narrative for their audience, and to remind and reassure them that the war was reasonably honorable and reasonably just, no matter on which side they had fought. This had implications not only for how people viewed the past, but how they viewed veterans in the present. Imagine if these writers' reports were not clinically detached, as Aaron put it, and less circumspect. That they had portrayed the conduct of war and all of its gory, morally ambiguous reality. What kind of public support would there have been for veterans in Mississippi or anywhere else after the war had the memoirist judged the terms of the fight to have been less than honorable, less than fair? There may not have been a veterans home in Mississippi or anywhere else in America had writers been more honest with themselves and their audiences. Memories of the war had political ramifications too. In the post-Civil War era, African-American veterans regularly called on the Union victory and their important role in fighting for it and winning it as they sought political and economic rights. They argued that their capacity for bravery and intelligence and manhood in a military capacity proved them ready and deserving of full citizenship after the war. Given this, we can see that the damaging consequences of the charges of cowardice that Lesley's USCT troops faced go beyond issues of collective honor. Tales of soldier conduct had the potential to make a real difference in both the opportunities afforded to and the limitations for reshaping white Americans' racial ideologies, and by extension, their willingness to expand political, civil, and economic rights to African Americans after the war. I think it's also useful to remind ourselves that Americans care deeply about the questions and issues of soldier conduct throughout our nation's history, and that indeed, of course, they still do. This concern wasn't limited to the Civil War. We can see the implications of this concern when we compare, for instance, the general historical consensus that American soldiers who fought in World War II conducted themselves bravely and humanely. This has fed into the narrative of that war as being a good war, and those veterans have helped propel themselves and their peers to become America's greatest generation. The soldiers who either volunteered for or were drafted to fight in Vietnam, on the other hand, were not always as esteemed for their conduct. And I think here we can make some useful connections with the irregular or guerrilla-style warfare that Aaron talked about in his paper. But in a war that most Americans felt ambivalent about from the beginning, reports of inhumane or dishonorable conduct by American soldiers helped to create a stigma for Vietnam veterans, which of course 40 years later has still not entirely faded. The same is true for wars that preceded the Civil War as well. We can look at the U.S. war with Mexico, for instance. It was a controversial conflict from the get-go. But after journalists repeatedly reported on the raping and pillaging and massacring committed by American forces in Mexico, the American public turned almost wholesale against it. By its end and forever after, it became, as Ulysses S. Grant wrote in his memoirs, a, quote, wicked war. And you'll recall that our country did not, as a nation, celebrate the sesquicentennial of the U.S. war with Mexico. So the fact that Americans have and still do care so much about these issues is in part because soldier conduct, whether it be courageous and honorable or cowardly and dishonorable, reflects upon the justness of the fight and the righteousness of any given war. American civilians now, as they did after the Civil War and throughout the 20th century, understand experiences of war to either improve a society or, conversely, to taint it. And tonight, these historians have shown us the very high stakes of these distinctions. Thank you.
We have a little bit of time for any questions. If anybody has some, yes, sir.
I have one for Eric.
Yeah.
I'm kind of rather surprised you didn't address the Palmyra incident in your talk, your comments on that.
So the Palmyra incident is, or the Palmyra massacre is what it's somehow known as. It's a Union general named John McNeil who executes 10 Missouri, sort of pro-Confederate Missourians. This is in 1862. The context is what he considers the unjust killing of a civilian who was a kind of pro-Unionist. It would have been a good one. I mean, I have I've been steeped in atrocities for too long, and I kind of selectively chose which to. I mean, there are, as it turns out, there are more than a few in the Civil War, and so. I don't know, and that's a good question. I actually don't know if McNeil wrote a memoir. I mean, Missouri is a very complicated place. So they're actually, Missouri is the only place that generates a whole literature of guerrilla memoirs. Most of the worst ones, Quantrill and Anderson, are killed, so they don't leave memoirs. But there's a guy, Edward Younger, who basically in the 1890s starts a career sort of telling us a myth, outlaw Josie Wales, right, of the kind of noble guerrilla. I mean, we sing songs about Jesse James, for heaven's sakes, right? I mean, this is like a murdering psychopath who has, thanks to Pete Seeger and Bruce Springsteen, though I love them both, been kind of rehabilitated as Robin Hood. And that's a remarkable transformation, just how effectively you can tell a story that just doesn't bear any resemblance at all to the historical reality. I'm actually, so that's a good question. I don't know with McNeil. I'm curious to look it up.
I didn't know how much you had found. The reason I mentioned it, it was one of the more publicized incidents of the war.
Yeah.
It was highly, there was a lot of outrage at that on both sides. And it did make some newspapers because of the, I believe it was the only incident during the war where civilians were just picked out of a town's population and without trial or due process, were accused of being Confederate spies, and I believe they were hanged. And that's why there was so much outrage from both sides.
Yeah.
That massacre. They call it a massacre. I call it an incident.
Yeah, I mean, on Civil War terms, it's a massacre. I mean, the largest mass killing is the one at Lawrence of 150. And there's no trial for the Lawrence massacre. That's just it's just a massacre. I mean, Missouri's history is in some ways unusual, and so trying to kind of disentangle how participants talked about it as opposed to these layers, I mean, to borrow Anne's phrase here, there are a lot of people telling very different stories about this. And it's partly to make Missouri livable in some senses, I mean, after the war, because a lot of Missourians stayed where they were. They kind of came back to their original, certainly those people who were expelled end up returning. And they have to live alongside people who might have supported that order. Stories are one way to help us do that, though we look back at them now and are, as historians, all of our red flags go up because they're not the right stories. They're inaccurate. They're politically necessary and they're strategic at the time. I mean, I mean, all of us are kind of being judgmental to a certain extent while recognizing that there's pretty good explanations for why these stories were framed the way they were.
Other questions? So, were there veterans of later wars who became inmates at Beauvoir?
No. Confederate homes are different than other soldier homes throughout the country. Like for the North, for example, you'll have earlier war and later war veterans in some of these homes. Beauvoir is a home for Confederate veterans who are living in Mississippi at the time they apply for entry, and it is funded entirely by the state because, of course, the federal government wouldn't fund
it. And it closes in 1950 because that's when the last 57. One dies?
There's three widows who are relocated. The last Confederate veterans had already died from the home.
Okay, so this is the antebellum home of Jefferson. Whatever.
Jefferson Davis, who went there after the war.
That you go to the first summer you move to Mississippi before you realize that nobody does stuff like that in the summertime, right?
We've all visited it.
Okay.
Summer.
Now, is the place where all these people stay that, I don't know if it's right, adjacent was, the big veterans complex that got washed away in Katrina?
You're talking about like a more the concrete type looking building. No. There were barracks all over the ground, wooden barracks, in my PowerPoint. You see these.
That were built as these people came home.
Exactly. And there's rooms, usually it was four residents to a room in these barracks. All of that is gone.
But the original Jefferson Davis antebellum mansion was the centerpiece.
That's the centerpiece that you see in all the photos.
So when you write about this, do you acknowledge and emphasize the irony of this antebellum, beautiful, you know, Old South, moonlight and magnolias razzmatazz, against the reality of the lost war, the poverty, the class issues? Do you do that?
Yeah, because.
Or will you do that?
Yes,
do that.
I promise. I already am. Part of that was in the talk, but I was looking at you guys, so like, I need to wrap this up. Help to make sure this would happen. They ran into all sorts of red tape and challenges. The sons of Confederate veterans step in, and they're the ones who kind of close the deal on the actual purchase of the home. After it opens, the state of Mississippi actually funds and runs the home. In the contract for the sale with that Verena Davis agreed to, once the home closed, it went back to the leadership of the Sons of Confederate Veterans. So, yeah, there's lost cause wrapped up in all of this. Absolutely. I mean, caring for the veterans is not just kind of how we tend to view veteran care, but it's also wrapped up into the memory of the Confederacy and the fact that the federal government's not going to pay for this.
Right.
When you take up arms against the federal government, you know, and so it's you know, as Anne noted, there's a lot of distinctions here that make it a fascinating story. Any other questions? Thank you all so much for coming out tonight, and thank you to the Moorman family.